Hello friends, today we will discuss about rotational mechanics. Now we had already discussed that mechanics has three branches. One is statics, other one is kinematics, third one is dynamics. Now in dynamics also there are two types of motion. One is linear motion, one is rotational motion. Linear motion we have already discussed. We discussed Newton's law of motion, we discussed what forces are causing those motions, and we also discuss frictional forces. Okay, we discuss about work energy and power. Now how circular motion is caused and what is the basic concept behind circular motion, we will discuss. Although we have discussed about it already, that centripetal acceleration is there, centrifugal force is there, but there is a basic concept which we will be going to learn in this, and that is torque and moment of inertia, which is responsible for the rotational motion. We have discussed what happens in rotational motion. We have discussed that force is required to keep it in a circular motion. And we have discussed that what is the force of the particular object which is moving in a circular motion. But what exactly produces that circular motion? That is, you know, when a body is rotating on the same point, okay, then the center of mass is constant, but still the body is moving. So what causes that motion, that we will discuss. Before we move further, we must understand what is the concept of center of mass. Till now we were assuming that the body, any body, is a point object. What is a point object? We were considering that the body is moving consecutively. All the particles in the movie are in the body are moving consecutively, simultaneously, and there is no lag. Okay, plus that every body is a point object. Okay, but exactly the body is not a point object. It consists of lot of point objects scattered, but the complete internal forces are acting in such a way that all the internal forces sum up to zero. Example, let us say this is a body, any solid or any liquid. If it is at rest, it is not that only it is just one point. It consists of lots of molecules, atoms, lots and lots of other particles inside. Now what happens is each of them exerts some internal forces on each other. But these forces, whichever they are acting upon a particular point, is such that the all sum up to zero. Means the total forces acting on a point internally is always zero. That is why the body is at rest, right? But continuously the forces are acting. Why? Molecular forces are there, atomic forces are there, right? Right. Nuclear fusion, nuclear fission. Now what happens is the body is still at rest, but the reactions keep on taking place due to internal forces. Okay, neutron forces, neutron and proton repulsion. Then attraction, sorry, and proton and electron attraction, then it keeps on revolving. So lots and lots of forces are acting inside, okay, but those internal forces are always zero, plus those particles are exerting forces on each other also. These are also internal forces. Now these particles are inside a body. Now this body is known as system or system of particles. It all depends upon us, how big the system we are assuming. Solar system, we call solar system. Why? Because it consists of 9 planets and sun. They are revolving around sun, but all total internal forces is always zero. Means the sun is exerting some force on planets, planets are exerting some force on sun. Total sum of all those forces is always zero. That is why I call it a system. Okay, so system of particles is nothing but it is designed in such a way that the body, it is such a body that all the forces acting inside are completely zero, unless and otherwise any external forces come into play. But if any external force is acting on that body, it will cause a motion. So the body will come into motion only when external forces act on this body. But there come a point which is mathematically assumed. It may be possible that on that particular point no mass exists, but mathematically it is assumed that every body has a center of mass where all the forces acting are all the forces are seemed or assumed to exist or assumed to act upon. Means there is a single point where the complete mass is concentrated. Okay, let us say here we want to find out the center of mass. What we will do, or to make it simple, let us consider just a single line, straight line. You know about the resultant, right? So let us say this is a position vector OA, this is another position vector OB. If we want to find out resultant of this vector, it will fall on this line, the line connecting these two vectors. Let us say it is R. This is A, this is B, this is R. We need to find out this point where we say that the mass is accumulated. Means these two bodies, these are particles in a system. Okay, A and B are particles in a system. OA and OB just represent their position. Okay, assumption we have taken. Okay, these are the position. We need to find out what is the resultant point where all the forces are assumed to exist. Let us say FAB will be the force which A exerts on B. Okay, FBA is the force which B exerts on A. Okay, these two forces are such that FAB plus FBA is equal to zero. We are assuming that there is no other particle, only these two particles exist in that system. So this force must be zero. Okay, then only it will be at rest, right? Now let us say M1 is the mass of this object, M2 is the mass of this object, and this object is moving with a velocity of V1, this object is moving with a velocity of V2. Okay, so linear momentum of each particle will become M1 V1. It will be of B, PB, and this is linear momentum. PA will be M2 V2. This is just to represent that V2 is a vector. This will be vector again. Okay. Now, we all know the change of linear momentum is what? Force. Now dPb upon dt will be m1 dv1 upon dt. This will be equal to force. Okay. Now let us say f, this v1, if it is in velocity or linear momentum is equal, let us say f1 is the force acting on this and f2 is external force. These are external forces, okay? Internal forces we have considered, FBA and FAB. Now, this F, now it is acting on what? B. So, FAB, A exerts on B, right? Plus F1, this is equal to this. and FBA plus F2 is equal to M2 dV2 by dt. Can be written like that. Adding these two equations, what we get? M1 dV1 by dt plus M2 dV2 by dt. This is equal to FAB plus F1 plus FBA plus F2. Now this plus this is 0. So this is equal to F1 plus F2. Only external forces. Okay, let us say this is equal to F, resultant vector. So we hereby know that internal forces are summing up to zero. Only external forces are responsible for the change in momentum or for the motion. Right? Let us take this forward. We have taken it is this. Okay. Now, this V1 is what? V1 is dR1 upon dt. What is R1? R1 is, let us say, this is the position and this is the position. Okay, we have represented AB. So let us say A. So this is nothing but dB upon dt plus M2 d upon dt dA upon dt. This is equal to F. It means M1 d square by dt into dv, sorry, b plus m2 d square by dt into a, this is equal to f. Right? Now, this will become what? Implies m1, sorry, d square by dt into m1b plus M2A is equal to F. Multiplying and dividing by the total mass of the system, which is M1 plus M2, we get M1 plus M2 multiplied by d square by dt whole multiplied by M1 b square plus M2 A whole divided by M1 plus M2. This is equal to F. Okay. But if we are considering this force, this will be equal to the resultant, right? This will be equal to what? F is equal to M1 plus M2, means the mass of the system, multiplied by what? Acceleration of this system, which is equal to d square r upon dt square. R is the resultant vector. Okay, we are taking into consideration the acceleration caused in the system. That is equal to the force. Force is equal to mass into acceleration. As simple as that. This is the equation, right? So if this is the equation and we equate, we find that r vector is equal to nothing but M1 B vector plus M2 A vector whole divided by sum of the mass, total mass of the system. So M1 multiplied by mass of the first vector multiplied by the vector position plus mass of the second vector multiplied by the vector position divided by the total mass of the system gives us the resultant vector position or the center of mass. This was what? Center of mass, right? So this gives us the center of mass. So what is center of mass? Center of mass is given by the subsequent mass multiplied by their respective positions divided by the total mass of the system. Now this can be extended to furthermore particles. Let us say there are n number of particles r1, r2, r3, dash 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 up to rn. These are the total respective location or position of the particles, and m1, m2, m3, mn be their respective masses. We can sum it up to, this is equal to m, so we will write it as summation. How we can write it? Like, we derive that it is equal to m1 r1 plus m2 r2 plus m3 r3 plus dash dash up to mn rn whole divided by m. This will give us the resultant vector. Right, so this can be generalized. This is nothing but m1 summation I is equal to 1 to n ri whole divided by m. Right, this is equal to r vector. So this can be given as the center of mass. How it can be realistically, you know, imagined? So let us take an example of square. Here there is a mass, here there is a mass, here there is a mass, here there is a mass. Let us say m1, m2, m3, m4. Right? If we want to find out the center of mass, let us say m1 is equal to m2 is equal to m3 is equal to m4, equal masses. So center of mass will come to the center of this geometrical object. We assume that for any geometrical body, the center of mass always comes to the center of the body. Okay, so for a pyramid, it will be coming up to a certain height, which can be found out wherever the means it is geometrical center of a body. Okay, now let us say we remove this mass. We remove this mass. Where the center of mass will shift? Here there is no mass. Okay, this mass will shift. Now this and this are cancelling out. Let us say these are equal, right? m m m. So center of mass will shift toward this side, let us say this point. Okay, now we remove this again. Again the center will come here only on the line of joining these two particles, because other two particles have no mass again. Now let us say we remove this, then center will become here. So it is all dependent upon mass and position of the vector, and if equal masses are acting, which is assumed to be, then the center of mass always occurs at the center of the geometrical shape. Okay, so real life example is, have you even seen a firecracker? What you call as pataka. Whenever you are, you know, making it go in the sky, it is just, you know, moving at a parabolic path As you know, everybody, whenever you launch it from the ground, it moves in a parabolic path, projectile motion. So at this point, it blasts. Okay? There are certain particles which moves like this, 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 this. Every particle is having its own parabolic path. Okay? But the center of mass of all those fragments, okay, this is complete body, right? These are its particles. They are moving here and there. The total, effective center of mass will always be on this path. No matter where these particles go, the effective center of mass will always be on this parabolic path, which was supposed to be if the firecracker did not blast. This is how it is realistically observed that center of mass concept is valid mathematically as well as physically. Now, as we know, three equation of motion, V is equal to u plus at, s is equal to ut plus half at square, v square is equal to u square plus 2as. We also have in rotational mechanics, as it is the basic concept required for rotational mechanics, the center of mass, we are now focusing what actually happens in the rotational mechanics when these equations are. V is w. What is that? Angular velocity. Now v is linear velocity. W is, sorry, omega is angular velocity. This is equal to omega naught, which is initial angular velocity. This is final angular velocity. Like this is final linear velocity. This is final angular velocity. This is equal to initial angular velocity plus alpha. Alpha is angular acceleration multiplied by t. In the same way, s here is theta. Theta is nothing but the angular displacement. It is equal to omega naught t plus 1 by 2 alpha t square. In the same way, omega square is equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha theta. Theta is angular acceleration. Now, how this is derived? In the same way where we derived this, these can be derived on the same basis. By analogy, you can remember that these are the equation. But the realistic view is like this. In linear, we say that this is displacement, right? O2 here. In angular, we say because motion is going like this, we say displacement is this. The main concept remains the same. These are the three equations of motion. Now, if theta is the main angular displacement, so what is theta? What is d theta upon dt? This is equal to omega, right? And what is d square theta upon dt square? This is equal to alpha, angular acceleration. Now this omega is equal to vr, right? Sorry, this omega is equal to v upon r, right? And this alpha is equal to v square upon r, or omega r square, right? You can put this to find out these equations. Plus, if theta is the angular displacement and alpha is the angular acceleration, alpha is what? Alpha is equal to final velocity minus initial velocity divided by t. Rate of change of velocity per unit time is known as angular acceleration. This is first equation. Similarly, on second equation, we can say that theta is the angular displacement. So if we know this equation, putting this equation in that, we can find out this. Just in the same way we found out this. Okay? These are the three equations of rotational mechanics. Now, we understood what is dot product. A dot B is equal to AB cos theta, where theta is the angle between A and B. This is what? This is scalar product. But we are concentrating on A cross B. This is equal to vector C, where C is again a vector. This is known as vector product or cross product. This is dot product, this is cross product. Now what is the rule of this product? Let us say A vector is going like this, B vector is going like this, then C will be going like this. Means, if the rotational motion is taking place in a particular plane, let us say anti-clockwise direction, the direction of the resultant force acting on a resultant action of these vectors is known as is given by A cross B, that is equal to C, and it is given by a right hand thumb rule. Anti-clockwise, this goes like anti-clockwise, the thumb is up. If it is going like clockwise, the thumb is down, means this is negative, this is positive, by convention only. So this is given by so if this is the rotational, means this position changed to this position, this is the rotation, then the direction of the resultant vector is up. If the direction is this, the resultant will be downwards. This is A cross B, and it is given by AB sine theta, where theta is the angle between two vectors. This is A, this is B, this is C. So theta is the angle between two vectors. It is given by AB sine theta. This is vector product. But why we are learning this vector product is because there is a very important concept in rotational mechanics, that is tau, which is known as torque. You always check a car's torque. Okay, it is a very high torque. Okay, your motor's torque, your screwdriver's torque. Okay, what is torque? Torque is that perpendicular force applied on a body so that a body moves on the fixed position. Okay, by that external force, there is no motion acting, taking place. The means the body is not moving from its one position to the other position, but it is rotating on the same position. Then that force applied is known as torque, and it is always given by tau is equal to F multiplied by perpendicular distance. For example, doorknob, you open it like this, okay? You don't open it like this, right? You open it like this in order to move the knob clockwise or anti-clockwise. This is known as torque. You are applying torque, okay? The force is in this direction, okay? The action is taking place perpendicular to that. So, when the action point is here, and you are applying force here, there is an axis of rotation, okay? Because when you are applying force on doorknob is like this. Point of action is this. You are applying force here by your hand. So force is here. This is axis of rotation, okay? And this rotates and the door opens. So what happens is, this force multiplied by this perpendicular distance, it is known as torque. Okay, it provides the rotational motion. So, you must have seen a crowbar. Let us say here it's a stone. You have seen a crowbar, it's like this. When you apply force here, it moves up, right, and it rotates, moves this stone forward, okay? But this is the axis of rotation, this is force, the action point is this. So here again it's torque. Your fan, electric force is acting here. Your fan is like this. It rotates, right? It rotates on the same point. There has to be some force acting perpendicular to something which is pushing or pulling it, okay? Which is given by the motor. That this is magnet is given here, electromagnetic coil is here. Force act in this direction or in this direction by repulsion or attraction of the magnet. And what happens is, by that force, point of action is the center of the motor due to which it rotates. So that is why torque is produced whenever there is a circular motion, or it is the cause of circular motion, in other words. So now let us find out, if we want to find out what is torque actually, let us say, this is a vector r. It moves by d theta. This is making an angle theta. This is x axis, this is y axis, and a force is acting somewhere here. Let us say F. This is having Fy component, this is having Fx component, right? It moves by d theta. Now it is r plus dr, it is resultant. We need to find out this. Let us say this is P, this is Q, this is O. Now, this displacement d theta is caused by what? F, right? So this force caused what? R plus dr minus r. This has been caused by F, right? F caused this. If we multiply this, we will calculate dw, which is work done. Work done on this particular point, mean particular object, to move it from here to here, it is F multiplied by this, right? Let us say this is dr, so F dot dr. Now, if dw is equal to F dr, which can be given as, now F can be written as I Fx plus J Fy. What is I Fx? I Fx is nothing but this particular component which is in horizontal direction, and J Fy is the component of this force in vertical direction. So this is force, and similarly dr can be given by I dr x plus j dr y. Okay, now if we want to calculate x of this r, it is given by x is equal to r cos theta and y is equal to r sin theta, which is this. This is y, this is x. This x is equal to r cos theta, y is equal to r sin theta, right? So if we want to find out dr, we will find out what? Let us say d theta we wanted to find out, right? So dr upon d theta, this is equal to what? X component of r, and means dx upon d theta I cap plus dy upon d theta j cap, implies dx upon d theta will become r into minus sin theta, and y it will become, this is dx upon d theta, and dy upon d theta will become r cos theta. Implies dx is equal to minus r sine theta d theta and dy is equal to r cos theta d theta. In other words, this is what? R sine theta is what? Y. This is minus y d theta. And this is what? This is x d theta. Let us substitute these. Substituting this, we get dw is equal to f x I cap plus f y j cap whole multiplied by x d theta minus y d theta. Right? Now, multiplying it, this is I cap, this is j cap. Dot product of this, we get this is equal to x f of y minus y f of x d theta. Because this was I cap, this was j cap. Since dx is equal to this much. So this is I cap, this is j cap. I into I, it will become minus f of x. And fy multiplied by this will become x f of y. So this is equal to this multiplied by d theta. Now, this is nothing but torque. Torque is equal to x f y minus y f of x. Okay? How? If you are confused here, it's nothing but dx is equal to minus y d theta, which is in I direction, means x direction. This is in j direction, which is y, dy upon d theta. So just in dot product, we multiply I by I and j by j. As simple as that. So this is the product. If we want to calculate it in polar coordinates, we will just write down. Now this is, let us say this f is making alpha angle here with the x coordinate. Overall angle which is being made with between r and f will become phi, right? So tau is equal to rf, sorry, x f of y minus y f of x, right? This is equal to x is what we found out, it is r cos theta. So r cos theta f of y minus y is what, r sine theta f of x. This is equal to r cos theta multiplied by fy. Fy is nothing but sine component of this, that is equal to f sine theta cos theta minus f, this is f sine alpha cos theta is f cos alpha sine theta. This is equal to rf sin alpha cos theta minus cos alpha sin theta. What is this? This is the formula of rf sin alpha minus theta. What is alpha minus theta? This is this angle is phi. So this is equal to rf sin phi. Means torque is position vector multiplied by the force acting on it, multiplied by sine of the angle between this vector and the force. Now what does it represent? Sine of this component. In other words, it is force sine component, which is this. This is known as what? Transverse component. And this is radial component, which is acting in the direction of this radius vector. It won't work. The thing which will work is the force acting perpendicular to this position vector, which is given by F sine phi. Right? So F sine phi will be the vector, means F sine phi will be somewhere around this. F cos phi will be somewhere around here. F cos phi, F sine phi. This is radial component which is acting in parallel with the vector. If you are putting some force in parallel with the vector, will it move in a circular motion? No. Circular motion will always be caused when it is moved in perpendicular to the position of the vector. So when you are moving perpendicular, only then motion is caused. Now the same thing, when you are thinking realistically, the same thing is being applied here. The sine of this force, it will only come into picture when we talk about torque. So torque is equal to Rf sine phi.